horse named Zombzany. And this wretched creature is Billy Bones, an old friend I dug up to assist me. Say hello to the living, Bill. I think that'll be quite sufficient, Bill. Kindly bring me the script. Take your time. Thank you, Sebastian. You got it. You'll be mistreated to the 1955 12-pot Republic cereal, Panther Girl of the Congo.
Real nightmare.
Was one of the last cereals produced in a lackluster effort. Compared to the ones produced in the 1940s, the mutant crayfish creatures themselves act with more emotion and vigorous quotes. The veteran cereal performer who stars as the cereal's heroine. I can only urge you to try to enjoy this feature for what it's worth.
Is there anything you would like to add, Bill? Behave yourself, Mr. Bones, or I'll be forced to ground you again. Okay, Myron, my fiendish assistant, let's get this show on the road.
Executive James Carreras set out to discover the reason for the success of the Quatermass experiment film, a.k.a. The Creeping Unknown in the U.S. of A. He discovered the film's realistic horror elements were what drew the audiences to the theaters. He wanted to produce a Frankenstein movie which would use realistic horror effects and revitalize the gothic horror genre. Hammer Warner Brothers Studios, The Curse of Frankenstein, 1957, set the stage for scores of Hammer horror films to follow and sparked the chemistry of actors Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee. The critics hated the movie, but the shadowy scenes and gothic mystique became a trademark of the small British studio, inspiring a new generation of horror fans in American culture dominated by teenage affection for mutated monsters and alien invaders. What do you think of that, Bill?
Sebastian, what's taking so long with that coffee I ordered? Hammer's Horror of Dracula, also released as Dracula. Thank you, Sebastian. Be gone. That'll be all for now. 1958 is responsible for the resurrection of the original Transylvanian film and considered the best Dracula movie ever made. Christopher Lee did not play the toothy Transylvanian in only one of the seven sequels. Peter Cushing portrays a less scholarly and more adventurous Van Helsing and appears in only three other sequels. Cushing suggested changing the original ending to something with an Errol Flynn touch, and he gets the idea of forming a cross with two candlesticks. Famous showdown scene.
Manic,
don't you
like vampires?
I don't like vampires, they suck.
The Mummy, 1959. Christopher Lee tries his hand at playing Kharith and emphasizes the ferocity of the misguided.
The Mummy, charisma!
The audience was shocked by the opening scene which showed the slave
charisma
having his tongue removed before being buried alive. Tell me that's not full budget shock value. Peter Cushing is splendid in his portrayal of archaeologist Roy Ashton, and body double Eddie Powell is noted for his daring stunt work during the filming. It is a common misconception that it is Lee who rises from the fall, when in fact it is Powell who got so wrapped up in delivering the drama, he had to the surface. One of Powell's other proud moments is when the mummy gets peppered with buckshot and the dust
packets on the wraps, and it's just giving more credibility to the character with makeup and effects.
Are you trying to upstage me?
I wouldn't be too demagogued.
Welcome back.
To a non-zombie movie. Call a Frankenstein movie, if you can believe it. Frankenstein created Woman in 1967. Peter Cushing plays a doctor for the fourth time in what is widely known as the first transsexual horror movie ever produced. It may also have inspired the cult movie Rocky Horror. It was announced in press releases as the fear of Frankenstein, and the doctor transplants brains instead of entire body parts. The film features Susan Denberg, a 1966-year-old centerfold, as the woman whose brain is swapped with that of her criminally minded boyfriend.
That must now be a nightmare.
Imagine the horror of a bony man.
Hello. I also like zombie movies, but obviously we're not going to get any right yet. Instead, we get to see another Dracula film. Oh boy. Dracula has risen from the grave in 1968. The third Christopher Lee portrayal of the film is the most religious orientated. The success of the film surprised Lee, who felt that the script committed too many vampires and blasphemies. He even wore the ornate ring Bela Lugosi sported in his movie as a tribute to the actor. The ravishing Veronica Carson's riveted and appealing wardrobe may have helped make the film a success with male members of the audience.
Can you say male members?
I can say anything I want to. I'm the host.
I forgot about that.
Dracula movies. Well, I told you vampires suck.
How do you know so much about vampires?
Whatever. Anyway. Taste the blood of Dracula. Yum. 1970, when Lee refused to recant the role, I wonder why, the studio considered doing a Dracula film without the famous count. Warner Brothers refused the concept, and Hammer had to beg Lee to do the film. His stock profit sharing option proved fruitful, so he reluctantly agreed to play the part, as well as the following. Lee is referred to having a strong dislike of the film after its release. In this version, Satanism results in the awakening of the Count, who in turn victimizes those who revamped.
Too clever.
If I were clever, I'd find a way to get rid of you.
Frankenstein must be destroyed. 1969. In this fifth Hammer Frankenstein, Lee, as the doctor, dons a mask while stalking victims. The monster is played by Freddie Elephant Man Jones, who is played off as a pathetic bald guy with stitches around his head. Veronica Carlson plays the female victim.
You can be my victim anytime.
The scriptwriters at Hammer dusted off a half-hour script by Kurt Sudermark for an ill-fated TV series called Tales of Frankenstein. The initial London release took place 4 months after the film was completed and featured Carlson being raped. Hammer Studio Chief James Carreras complained there wasn't enough sex needed in the script. This film contains some silly bits, most noted is the body being pushed through the soil when a water pipe breaks, and the doctor using a drill and saw to remove a brain. Now, that's what I call making a zombie the hard way. Despite its lapses, many ardent fans insist it is the best Frankenstein movie ever produced.
Can you guess what our next movie's gonna be?
Zombies!
No? Yes.
Frankenstein! Oh no!
particular AD 1972, aka Dracula Today and Dracula Chases the Mini Girls. Placing Dracula in a modern setting was considered by Arden fans as a big mistake.
Christopher Lee plays the Count, who was awakened by a group of mod rock and rollers. The first Dracula film set in London, and initial theater runs featured a short by the Count Dracula Society entitled Horror Ritual. The film features Stephanie Beecham as Van Helsing's granddaughter, who the Count uses to lure the vampire hunter to his castle. The party scene featuring the American band Stone Ground is still considered a major low point casting blunder by perverted Dracula fans.
Perverted Dracula fans?
I believe I said perverted, you illiterate dummy. I'd put you to bed now, but I think it's time to do the sign off.
I thought put me to bed was the sign off.
Oh yeah, it is. Go to Black.
Zombie Count, just for laughs.
Yeah, okay.
Frankenstein is monster or zombie?
Monster.
Dracula?
Monster who makes people zombies.
Precisely, a monster. The mummy?
Mummy.
Did you see any other zombies?
Phyllis Coates, zombie.
Two zombies. Oh, I recall calling the mummy one a bit of a stretch. You know, I should refuse to do this event in the future unless I can present true zombie movies and hope they don't throw in those Night of the Living Dead movies, because they don't fit the bill either.
I kinda dig Romero.
Just for that, you're permanently grounded.